it's still a very famous experiment. And in fact, far more people have heard about Schrödinger's cat than have any idea who is Schrödinger or what the cat was doing. Schrödinger's cat is what physicists call a thought experiment.
What's called a Gedanken thought experiment from the German, that one I know.
This is an experiment that you'd like to do and you can talk about the consequences, but could you never do in practice? Like, what would happen to the Earth when it was going round and round if the sun disappeared? You could never make the sun disappear, but you could still calculate what would happen to the Earth. Schrödinger was an Austrian physicist who, when the Nazis invaded Austria, fled to the UK and then to Dublin, where he had quite a colourful career and actually fathered an illegitimate child. But that's nothing to do with his cat. In the cat experiment was something he proposed to try and explain an idea, or how stupid he thought one of the ideas that had been proposed by quantum physicists working in Copenhagen, who were discussing how if you couldn't observe something which had two possible states, the two states could be muddled together so you couldn't tell which was which.
Schrödinger's cat is a thought experiment in which a cat is put in a box.
Schrödinger's cat thought experiment. Well, it goes something like this.
Imagine you have a cat. I'm sorry, this is not a very good model, but you can imagine this is a cat which can either be alive or dead. And his idea was that you have a steel box which can be closed so that the hole, it can be cut off completely from the outside and nobody, not even physicists, can see inside. So the idea is that you put the cat in the box. And at the same time, you put inside a small vessel that contains a tiny amount of a radioactive material. And the radioactive material has a few atoms, and you choose the number of atoms so that during a period of, say, an hour, there's a 50% chance that one of them might decay radioactively and give out a particle. So you put that in the box. So now you have the cat and the radioactive material. You then take a Geiger counter. Here we have a very fine Geiger counter, which can detect whether the radioactive decay has taken place or not. And then, and this is the cunning part, you connect the Geiger counter to a hammer, which, if it detects something, it will break a small glass container containing cyanide, which is poisonous, which will come out and kill the cat. So we now close the lid and we start timing. So we know that while the box is closed, inside, during the period of 1 hour, there's a chance that a radioactive decay might take place.
There's no way of us predicting, no matter how many equations we write down, how much physics we try to do, that is a quantum process and we simply can't predict it.
And if it takes place, the Geiger counter triggers, gets the hammer smashes the cyanide, and the cat dies.
The key question that Schrödinger asked, or the key Gedanken experiment that he put forward, is, well, think about what is the state of the cat before you open the box.
Since we don't know whether the radioactive decay has taken place or not, under this idea proposed by the people in Copenhagen, the cat doesn't know whether it is dead or alive.
You've got no way of knowing whether the cat in the box is alive or dead. Quantum mechanically, what you would say is that the cat is in a superposition of states. It's both alive and dead.
And it's only when the hour is up and we open the door that we then determine whether the cat is dead or alive. But while the door is shut, the cat is in this mixture of dead and alive state. Now, the point of this experiment, at least as far as I know as a chemist, was that Schrödinger said, this is a crazy idea. You can't have a cat that is dead or alive.
Now, Schrödinger's idea was to bring this strange quantum business to bring it perhaps to the general public, but also to make it the thing more real and relevant.
The genius of this experiment and why people have thought about it so long and still get excited is because it links an event on the atomic scale, one atom disintegrating or not, to something that everybody can understand, the cat being dead or alive. So you can't tell whether the cat's dead or it's alive.
I mean, clearly the cat is never half dead and half alive. It's either alive and dead. And I think the usefulness of the of Schrödinger's cat story is a caution. It's really a cautionary tale that we have to use different rules of thinking when we're dealing with everyday objects like cats and quantum objects.
So Schrödinger came up with this to actually to try and show the pitfalls with some elements of the quantum mechanical concepts, because it is such a very strange concept. He wanted to try and show the ludicrousness of thinking like this, the idea that the cat is in two separate states at the same time. It's both alive and dead. And this was that's the Copenhagen interpretation, that you can have this superposition of states. Schrodinger really wanted to show that that wasn't the case and that it was just ludicrous to think like that. But the problem is, we've done experiments, and at this quantum level, that's how matter behaves.
Our everyday notions of things being in well-defined states for large-scale objects just do not apply at the quantum level, and we have to use just other ways of thinking, and that's what quantum mechanics is.
I mean, there are lots and lots of examples. The one, probably the most famous one, is the electron has a spin. It in some sense behaves like a little tiny spinning top, but it's a weird quantum mechanical kind of spin, so it has all sorts of strange properties associated with it. But you can think of an electron as a little spinning top. And so one of the classic sort of superposed states you can have is you can actually, you know, there are two ways a thing can spin, right? It can go clockwise or anti-clockwise. You can actually have an electron that hasn't yet made up its mind which state it's in. So it actually is in a superposed state where it's both rotating one way and rotating the other way at the same time. And it's only when you do an experiment to actually measure the properties of that electron that it collapses into one state or the other. So it spins clockwise or anti-clockwise. And so that's an example of a quantum mechanical object which can fundamentally be in two states at the same time.
Einstein got very excited about this and wrote to Schrödinger later, except that in Einstein's case, he imagined it with explosives rather than cyanide, which perhaps might be more dramatic, but is no good, because if the explosive went off, it would destroy the box, so it would spoil the idea of the experiment.
I thought Einstein was clever. That's a stupid idea.
Well, perhaps he had a strong box.